Hi there. In this tutorial, I'm going to demonstrate how to use Dynamic Paint to control the fire effect to create something like this. You can see how the fire is running around this surface. It's not actually an object giving off flame that's moving around. It's the plane itself emitting fire in accordance with a Dynamic Paint effect. And these other objects are just there so you can see the light reflecting off. And I'll show you how to basically create something like this, which you may find useful for other things. So here's the scene with everything completed, and if I play it you can see things moving around, and you can actually see a weight paint effect, which is the dynamic paint effect, moving around, and that's what's used as the source of the fire. You should also be able to just about make out there's a little lamp moving around there as well. So I'll go back to the beginning, I'll make a new scene. And I should say, although this is defaulted to Cycles Render, this is a Blender render only effect. Although you can set everything up in any render engine you wish, in order to render it, you will need to be in Blender Render, because unfortunately, you can't render volumetrics in Cycles Render. So I'll repeat that once more, it must be in Blender Render mode to be able to render this effect out. So we'll start by adding a plane. Press S to scale it, and type 10 to scale it up. And having scaled it up, what we'll now need to do is subdivide it, because at the moment we've only got four vertices. So we'll look at it from the top, bring up the menu on the left hand side, and press W and subdivide. We'll wind the subdivisions right up to 10, but in actual fact that's nowhere near enough, not for what I want to do. So I'm going to set it to 70 subdivisions. You can see that's a lot of little squares now. So I can come out of edit now. The next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to add another object, which is going to be a cylinder. So I'll scale that, but not on the Z, because I want it to have a bit of height, reasonably small, and just to make it easy to see, we'll give that a green colour. So there it is. The first thing I need to do is make that move around in some fashion. Obviously there are many different ways to animate. I'm going to use a very simple method, which is I'm going to add a curve, which is going to be a circle, scale it up a little bit, go into edit mode, take some of these points, G, Shift, Z, so it only moves on the X and Y, and move these points around a little bit. We'll take that one in a little, and then G, Shift, Z, and I can even double it over like that, and so on. So I've now got a sort of looped effect there, made out of a Bezier curve. So I go back to my little cylinder, go to constraints, add an object constraint, and tell it to follow path. Before I do anything else, I'm going to Control A and apply rotation and scale, because things can get a bit messed up sometimes if you don't do that. Now I'll tell it to follow the Bezier circle, and we'll click animate path. I'll select my Bezier circle and go to 250 frames, which is the current length of my animation. And then if I click play, you can see my little cylinder is running around following that Bezier curve. So I've got my moving object. We'll save that. So the next thing I need to do is make that affect this plane. So first of all, I'll select the plane, come under physics effects on the right hand side, and select dynamic paint. I want it to be a canvas, so I then click add canvas. I'll deal with the rest of the settings in a moment, but I'll now go back to my cylinder, click dynamic paint, but this time select brush and click add brush. And now if I click play, you can already see something's happening. It's starting to affect the plane in a limited way, but it is doing it. One of the things that you will find you want to do is play around with certain elements, such as substeps, especially if you've got an object moving very fast. I've got the plane selected now, and under dynamic paint, substeps is basically how many calculations Blender does between each frame. Now with an object moving quite quickly like this one is, and I'm currently set to 24 frames a second, there's actually a gap between one where the object is in one frame and where it is in the next frame. So I have to tell Blender to go and do some tweening, some in-betweening calculations between those two frames to try and smooth that out. So I'll set this up to maximum, which is 10, and you can already see we get at least a slightly smoother line. It's not perfect, but it's better than it was. We can also click anti-alias, and that smooths things out quite a lot. Again, it's more to do with just making the line look smooth than anything else. Yeah. And you can see it's there. Now it's not perfect, as I said. You can play around with things like the frame rate. You could go up to 60 frames a second and so on, and that would improve that still further. So the next thing we need to do is actually do something with that. So we'll save that. So we now need to come down to what the dynamic paint output is going to be. and I want it to be a weight paint. So we come down to Dynamic Paint Advanced, and it's weight that we're going to use. You see it's all turned blue there. If I click play now, you can see it's a weight paint map now that we're getting. So where it's blue, that's zero. Where it's red, that's maximum. And the output, which is here, the default is called DP weight. You can call it anything you like, but while it's red, it's not going to output anything. So you need to click the plus here, and that's now going to output a vertex group called DP weight. So the next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to select my little widget here. You can use various different things for indicating where the weight should be set. At the moment it's on mesh volume, so it's basically anything in the canvas that's within the volume of this object is marked. But what I want to use is volume and proximity. We go back to the beginning then. Now you can see we have a much thicker line, and you can see how it fades out. And you can set the paint distance. So if I set that to 0.75 and put it back to the beginning again, you can see it's a slightly thinner line. And obviously I can play with that. So that's pretty good. You can see it's marking out where our Bezier curve is. But I don't want the whole thing to end up on fire. What I want it to do is to fade out. So what I now need to do is go to my canvas again, turn anti-aliasing on again, and click fade. Now it's currently set to fade over 250. So in other words, that would take, for the very beginning bit here, the entirety of this animation for it to be completely faded. So I'm going to set that to something more like 50. And now you can see it's like a little comet tail following it around, maybe 75. And you can see that's working, that's running around. Only where it's red is the vertex group at its maximum. And what you will most likely need to do is to bake that before you do anything further with it, because it can get a little difficult. Sometimes things don't work quite as expected. So go down to Dynamic Paint Cache with the canvas selected and click Bake. Depending on your settings, that shouldn't take too long to do. There's numbers inside that little black box, by the way, are percent complete. So that's now baked. So as long as you don't change any settings associated with the dynamic paint, that's that. And I can even move my cylinder and my Bezier curve to another layer so that I don't see them, and I'll still get my weight paint moving around. Okay, so now to add the fire. We'll just save that. We'll select the canvas and go Object, Quick Effects, Quick Smoke. Now it sets the plane into wireframe view. Doesn't really matter too much, but we'll set it back to solid. And it's added a domain, which is the fire domain, or smoke domain. And what I'll do is I'll go into edit mode so that I can lift the domain up to about there, so that its origin point is near the bottom. It does need to enclose that plane reasonably well, and then scale it on the z-axis a little bit. Doesn't need to be too much. And then we'll have a look at what our camera view is looking like. So I'll press G and zoom the camera back a little bit, move it up a little bit, and then tilt it down, and move it back a little further. So when we press play now, we can see things going on, but we can also see there's a lot of smoke appearing. So I'll now add a lamp, so that we don't just get black smoke. Add lamp, and we'll add a sun lamp. Bring that up here. Doesn't really matter where a sun lamp is, all you're really setting is the angle of the lamp. And then we should see, you can see there's light shining on the smoke. But at the moment, obviously we've just got huge amounts of smoke, and it's not even flame at the moment. So if I come over to the physics panel, select my plane in the middle, which is the source of my flame, well, smoke at the moment, and I'll just set that to fire. And we'll go back to the beginning and trigger it off, and there we go. There typically is some smoke coming from it even when it's set to just fire, and you can change that. But you can see we're getting fire from it, but it's obviously not associated with that weight paint yet. But that's simple enough. We come down to here under Smoke Flow Advanced, under Vertex Group, set that to DP Weight, and then click Play. And you should be able to see now we're getting smoke and fire coming from the weight paint. I'm not going to go into a lot of detail about smoke and fire at the moment, but there's a few things you'll want to do. You'll probably want to set the subdivisions up to at least 64. I think I did 128 for my simulation. You can see it's slowing down now. You'll want to put adaptive smoke domain on. What that does is makes this little inner box. And also, what I did to speed things up is I reduced the amount of smoke. So I think I put it to something like 0.1, which means there's less volumetric particles other than the flame itself to create. You can also add smoke high resolution, which makes a nicer flame, but obviously makes it work harder. You can increase this number here, you can change this one. This is the noise effect, the sort of wobbiness of the flame. In addition, you can look at things like the speed. So if I put this to 0.5, this will actually make the flames roar quite a bit higher. So if I stop it there, and we do a render, and you can see there is our flame, very low resolution flame at the moment, and our plane. So what I'd also do is I'll set this sun lamp down to a much lower energy. In fact, what I'm going to do is I'll change it to a spot lamp, which is what I did on the other one, simply because it creates shadows and things like that. I'll also set my scene down to 50%. Now, another thing you can do to speed up the rate at which your volumetrics render is to change the step size. For a high quality render, you need a small number, and this is already set to quite a small number, but it also obviously takes longer to render. So you may want to try something like 0.75 while you're doing draft renders. So let's give that a go. And you can see it's very crude, so we'll go back to 0.45. And that's good enough for a draft render. But at the moment, obviously, there's no light coming from my flame, as you can see. So I'll add a few cubes, move those around a little bit, just to have some objects for light to shine off. We'll give them a basic texture, and we'll see what that looks like through the camera. So there they are. It's obviously very dim in there at the moment, and I'll change the world to a black background, because I find the grey quite distracting when I'm doing volumetrics. Okay, that's quite dim. I think we'll just turn the lamp up slightly and we'll see what that looks like. Okay, that's good enough for now. There's some issues with the biasing on there which we can improve, but that's good enough for now. So how do we get some light following the flame around? Pretty straightforward. If I bring back the layer with my object, I'll add a lamp which will be a point lamp. Look from above, position it roughly over that object, raise it up somewhat. Need to be in perspective to help with selecting, and what I need to do is select my moving object, control P and say object, make sure that this is on main layer, and we should now have an object, a lamp, yep, which follows the volumetrics. And if we let that get somewhere near one of the cubes about there and render that, and you can certainly see there's light coming from it now. And what we can do, obviously, is change the color of it. We can say we want shadows. We can play with the distance of it as well. So I might say just 2 on the distance, a sphere. Render that, let's see what that looks like. And perhaps we want a bit more than that on the distance. Put the samples up a bit and the threshold up a bit. And that's basically how it works. And if I now just do a render with the step size down at a reasonable level, and that's basically it. So I hope you found that useful. If you did, let me know. If you've any requests for other tutorials, just say so in the comments below. I've got quite a few others to do. There's been quite a few requests and I'm working my way through them. But if there's anything particularly you'd like me to do a tutorial on, by all means, just let me know. Thanks a lot. Bye then.